Okay, today it's good to be with you. Hi, folks. Hope you're okay. It's good to be with you. We're looking at the Living Christ and the Four Gospels by R.W. Dale, which is an old apologetics book written over 100 and so years, 120 years ago at least. And we're looking at lecture nine by R.W. Dale. On Tatian. Now, in historical Jesus studies, Tatian is a very important figure in learning about Jesus because of some of the editing that he did. He edited the four Gospels. So we're going to read the chapter on Tatian and talk about what I'm reading. R.W. Dale says, in his address to the Greeks, Tatian tells us that he was born in Assyria, that in his youth and early manhood he was instructed in the laws, the literature, and the religious beliefs of the Greeks, that he travelled in many lands and became familiar with the customs and philosophies of many races of men, that he carefully considered their religious rites and was initiated into their mysteries. According to Eusebius, he was a sophist, a professional rhetorician, and a lecturer with distinction on various branches of Greek learning. At last, to use his own phrase, he withdrew into himself that if possible he might discover the truth. While he was earnestly engaged in this inquiry, he happened to meet with certain barbaric writings, as he calls them, some of which were more ancient than Homer. That the earliest of the writers who were honoured by the Greeks are more ancient than even their legendary heroes. The sacred books of the Jews attracted him by the simplicity of their style, by the naturalness and sincerity of their writers, by the knowledge of future events which was shown in their prophecies, and by their admirable moral precepts, and by their teaching concerning the unity and supremacy of God. In Christ he found the fulfilment of Jewish hope, and so he became a Christian. It's disputed whether he became an Orthodox Christian. He seemed to apostatize in his later life, so we'll come back to that in a minute. About the middle of the second century, he was in Rome. At this time, he was intimately associated with Justin Martyr and was a conspicuous defender of the Christian faith. He tells us that Cretans, a philosopher, was the bitter enemy of both of them and plotted their death. During the life of Justin, his opinions were orthodox, but after the death of his friend, his name was associated with some serious heresies. He came to hold severe views concerning the evil of the flesh and denounced marriage as a crime against the higher life of the soul. He was also charged with adopting some of the speculations of Valentius and the Gnostic. When he left Rome, he appears to have travelled eastward, and his last years were probably spent among his countrymen on the banks of the Euphrates. Although he regarded Justin with affectionate admiration, the two men were very unlike. Justin could never wholly forget the charm of his old philosophical studies and speaks with sympathy of those who, by adventurous path of speculation, were endeavoured to find their way to the secret of the universe and to the life of God. Tatian, who was probably a more learned man than Justin, assails every form of human philosophy with fierce contempt. Pythagoras, Plato, and Aristotle, Heraclitus, and Diogenes, he scorns and ridicules them all. He exalts in the traditions, some of them quite untrustworthy, of their infirmities and vices, and he mocks at their claims to wisdom. A very few years ago, it would have been necessary to say that of all his numerous writings, only his address to the Greeks remains. But to the astonishment and delight of scholars, the most important and valuable of his lost books has been recently recovered. The story of the recovery is so interesting that I will venture to tell it, says W. Dale. He goes on, in several ancient authors there are references to what is called described as Tatian's Diasatron. Eusebius says that Tatian composed a sort of connection and compilation, I know not how, of the Gospels and called it the Diatasatron. This work is current in some quarters even to the present day. Epiphanius about AD 315 to AD 43 informs us that the Diatessaron Gospel said to have been composed by him, Tatian. It is called by some the Gospel according to the Hebrews. In 5453, Theodoret, Bishop of Cyrus near the Euphrates, writes, he, Tatian, composed the Gospel, which is called the Diatessaron, cutting out the genealogies and such other passages, show the Lord to have been born of the seed of David according to the flesh. This work was in use not only among persons belonging to his sect, but also among those who followed the apostolic doctrine, as they did not perceive the mischief of the composition, but used the book in awesome simplicity on account of its brevity. And I myself found more than 200 such copies held in respect in the churches of our parts. All these I collected and put away and replaced them by the Gospels of the four evangelists. This testimony is important, says Dale. Theodoret knew the book had been carefully examined, it, and his words clearly imply that it was a compilation of the four Gospels, with certain passages cancelled which were consistent with Tatian's heresies concerning the necessary evil of the flesh. There is also a reference to the Diatessaron in the Doctrine of Ardea, a kind of romance written in Syriac, professing to give an account of introduction of Christianity into Edessa. It contains the legend of Abgarus, the king of Edessa, who, when suffering from an incurable disease, is said to have heard the miracles of our Lord and to have sent a message to him appealing to his pity and imploring him to come to Edessa. The romance gives the following account of the worship of the church, which was found in Edessa after our Lord's resurrection. Quote, this is Hemphill. The romance was first published in Dr. Curriton's Ancient Syriac Documents, 1864. Quote, they ministered in the church which Adeus had built at the order of the command of King Abgar, and they were furnished from what belonged to the king, to his nobles, with some things for the house of God and others for the supply of the poor. But a larger multitude of people assembled day by day and came to the prayers of the service and to the reading of the Old Testament and the new of the Diatessaron. End of quote. The story told in the Doctrine of Ardea is wholly untrustworthy, but it shows that the Diatessaron must have been in common use in the Syriac church when the book was written. There is another testimony from a Syriac bishop, Bar Salabi, who lived at the end of the 12th century. He says that the Diatessaron quotation began with the opening verse of John's Gospel. He also says that the Ephraim at the Syria, about AD 308 to AD 373, theologian, poet, and orator, saint, wrote a commentary on it. Tatian, the disciple of Justin, the philosopher and martyr, selected and patched together from the four Gospels and constructed a Gospel which he called the Diatessaron, that is, miscellaneous. On his work, Mar Ephraim wrote an exposition, and its commencement was, "In the beginning was the Word." This was about all that was known in England of the Diatessaron. When Dr. Lyford wrote the article on Tatian, which appeared in the Contemporary Review for May 1877, and the evidence did not satisfy those who were willing to believe that as early as the middle of the second century or little later, our four Gospels had not only been written but had secured so uncontested a supremacy that even a heretic like Tatian recognized their authority and used them as the basis of his narrative of our Lord's early history. Of the witness whose testimony has been quoted, it is at least doubtful whether Eusebius had seen the book. It is certain, I think, that Epiphanius had not seen it, and the great writers of the West knew nothing of it. Victor of Capua, indeed, who flourished about the middle of the 6th century, had met with a harmony of the Gospels and supposed that it was the one which, according to Eusebius, had been composed by Tatian. But Victor calls it the Diapente, not the Diatessaron, and it begins with the first verse of Luke instead of the first verse of John. It was only from the three Syrian witnesses, Theodoret and the writer of the Doctrine of Ardea, and Balsalabi that any clear satisfactory evidence could be derived. But Dr. Lightfoot maintained with great force that the traditional view of the church was sound, that Tatian had compiled a story of our Lord's life from the four Gospels and had called it the Diatessaron. If Ephraim's commentary on the Diatessaron had been preserved, the controversy might have been closed, for the commentary would certainly show the general structure and outline of the book, and would probably contain many quotations from it. Unfortunately, early in the last century, a ship laden with ancient manuscripts for Pope Clement VI sank in the Nile, and many of Ephraim's writings were lost, among them perhaps his lecture on the Diatessaron. To recover the lost book from the bed of the Nile was impossible. It perished long ago, but might not some other copy be still in existence? Strangely enough, at the very time that Dr. Lightfoot was writing his article and building up his laborious argument, he had Ephraim's lecture on his own bookshelves, and they had been there for several years. An Arminian translation of them had been published in 1836 by the Mekitarist monks who are settled on the island of San Lazzaro in the lagoon between Lido and Venice. These monks have had a remarkable history and have done a remarkable work. Mechita, the founder of the order, was an Armenian and was born in 1676 in Siwa, the ancient Sebastian, a town near the source of the Halys, on the borders of Pontus and Cappadocia. In 1699, he was ordained priest and came to be possessed with a passion for promoting both the intellectual and spiritual welfare of his countrymen. He went to Constantinople and formed an association to carry out his design. Difficulties arose which led him to transfer his new society to Modon in the Morea, which at that time belonged to Venice. Here he and his companions worked for 14 years until 1715. The Morea was recovered by the Turks and Machita's convent was broken up. He then received from the government of Venice the island of San Lazzaro. And from that time, the Venetian convent had been the mother house of the order and the center of Armenian culture. Other congregations had been founded in Vienna, at Trieste, and several places in Hungary. The Allgemeine Zeitung, December 17, 1850, bears a strong testimony to the great services which the Mekitarists have rendered to their fellow countrymen. It says, when one takes a nearer view of their labours at Vienna and Venice, one is amazed at the powerful influence which the literary activity of these learned monks exert on the Armenian nation scattered throughout the East. The reviews, the books, the numerous translations of works on history, geography, philosophy, natural science, and voyages and travels, which are printed in the Machaerus Press of Vienna and Venice, are carried far beyond Persia to the banks of the Indus and the Ganges, and have everywhere called forth among them Arminians the desire of knowledge and a taste for reading, and set on foot a literary movement which was before entirely dormant in a people till lately essentially and exclusively commercial. Among the treasures of the library, the monks possessed two 12th century MS of an Arminian translation made apparently in the 5th century from the Syriac of Ephraim's commentary on a gospel harmony. In 1836, they published an Arminian edition of Ephraim's work in four volumes, Octavio, and the commentary is contained in the second volume. Quote, I for some years, says Dr. Lightfoot, writing in 1889, possessed a copy of this work, and the thought had more than once crossed my mind that possibly it might throw light on Ephraim's mode of dealing with the gospels, as I knew that it contained notes on St. Paul's epistles or some portion of them. I did not, however, then possess sufficient knowledge of the Arminian to sift its contents, but I hoped to investigate the matter when I had mastered enough of the language. End of quote. But even without knowledge of Arminian, Dr. Lightfoot might have known the contents of the Ephraim's lectures before he published his article on May 1877. For in 1876, a Latin translation had been published in Venice. As early as 1841, one of the monks, Father Uke, I translated the lectures into Latin, but the translation had remained in MS in the library of San Lazzaro. At last it somehow came to the knowledge of Dr. George Mosinger, professor of biblical studies at Salzburg, and it was placed in his hand with one of the MS from which the Arminian text had been printed. He revised the translation and published it, as I have said, in 1876. Dr. Wace, who wrote a series of admirable articles on the Diatessaron in the Expositor for 1881 and 1882, justify remarks that considering the immense importance of Ephraim's work, it is most curious point that it should have been before the world for nearly 5 years in a Latin translation and should have remained practically unnoticed by any of the laborious scholars of Germany. He adds, such an ancient might well lead us to think that our materials for criticism are beginning to overpower us and that some of our best treasures may be hidden for us like needles in a haystack. End of quote. It also curious that the importance of the discovery was at last brought home to the scholar of Germany and England by an American theologian, Dr. Ezra Abbott, who called attention to it in his book on authorship of the Fourth Gospel, published in 1880. The lectures, as Dr. Wace prefers to call them, the Scholia of Ephraim, demonstrated that the Diatessaron of Tatian, published soon after the middle of the second century, was continuous narrative of our Lord's life, consisting of a close welding together of the four Gospels. How much of the contents of the Gospels Tatian omitted could not be confidently inferred from Ephraim's lectures, for the lectures are not a continuous commentary. Out it was certain that Tatian used all the four and no other. But the romantic story of the Diatessaron is not yet finished. The discovery of Ephraim's lectures had been followed by the discovery of the Diatessaron itself. 150 years ago, Stephen Evodius, a Samanite, a Syrian Maronite, and a member of a family of famous Orientalists, assisted his uncle Joseph Aloysius in his work at the Vatican Library, and he published, among other learned books, and accounts of the Oriental manuscripts contained in the library. In this, there is a brief notice of an Arabic MS professing to be a translation of the Diatessaron of Tatian. Brief accounts of it were also given by Archibald and the younger Rosenmuller. Archibald, a Swedish scholar who was famous for his runic, Coptic, Phoenician, and ancient Egyptian learning, died about 70 years ago. The younger Rosenmuller, professor of Oriental literature at Leipzig, died some years later. But the accounts which these three eminent scholars had given of the MS were meagre and unsatisfactory. The discussions which were occasioned by the publication of Ephraim's lectures recalled attention to these notices of the MS, and Sizer, one of the scribes of the Vatican, promised in 1883 to give a fuller and more accurate description of it, and if he had the leisure to publish it in full. Circumstances delayed the fulfilment of both promises, but in the year 1886, an eminent dignitary among the Catholic Coptics was visiting Rome, and Caesar showed him the Tatian MS. He said that a similar one was in possession of a number of his communion in Egypt. In the course of the summer, this second MS, which is described as beautifully written and illuminated in gold colours, was sent to Rome, and in 1886 it was published. It contains notes at the beginning and end in which it is described as an Aramaic translation of Tatian's Diatessaron. Made from the Syriac, it gives the name of the translators and also the names of the writers of the Syriac MS from which the translation was made. The translator lived in the early part of the 11th century, the writer of the Syriac MS at the end of the 9th century. The Egyptian MS supplied passages which are wanting in the imperfect MS in the Vatican, and it is free from the interpolations which are recognizable in that MS. The date of this translation shows that 6 centuries after Theodoret had collected 200 copies of the Diatessaron from the churches of his diocese and replaced them with copies of the four Gospels, there were Assyrian Christians who still clung to the book from which their fathers in the second century had learnt the story of Christ. But their country was under the Sarrasine yoke, and they had forgotten the mother tongue of their race, and they were speaking the language of their conquerors, and so the Diatessaron was translated into Arabic. In its contents and in the order which the facts of our Lord's life are narrated, the Arabic Diatessaron is practically identical with the Syriac Diatessaron, which was used by Ephraim. Except in the four instances, the order in which the passage of the Gospels are cited by Ephraim, in the order which they occur, is in the Arabic harmony. It begins with. Begins with five verses of the Gospel of John. Then follows the account of the birth of John the Baptist contained in the first chapters of Luke. Then the appearance of the angel Joseph told by Matthew. Then the story of our Lord's birth, the appearance of the angels to the shepherds, the prophecy of Simeon and of Anna as given by Luke. Then the visit of the Magi, the flight into Egypt, the slaughter of the children of Bethlehem, and the return of Joseph and Mary to Nazareth as told by Matthew. From this point, Ephraim passes to the great words in the first chapter of John, and the word became flesh and dwelt among us. Through Moses is the law, but its truth through Jesus our Lord. Grace and truth came through Jesus. The Jews sent John and say to him, "Who art thou?" And he confessed, saying, "I am not the Christ." They say to him, "Art thou Elias?" He says, "No." But the Diatessaron, after the slaughter of the children and after the return to Nazareth, gives Luke's account of our Lord's visit to Jerusalem when he was 12 years of age. This is followed by a brief statement of the beginning of the ministry of John the Baptist, and then follows John chapter 1, 7 to 28, which contains the passages just quoted from Ephraim. In Ephraim, singularly enough, the comments on our Lord's visit to Jerusalem in his whole boyhood occurred after the comments on his testimony of the Baptist. This is one of the four cases in which Ephraim's order differs from the order of the Arabic Diatessaron. Until the story reaches the selection of the 12 apostles, Tatian shows considerable freedom in his agreement of the incident. But later, this, and beginning with the Sermon on the Mount, he practically follows Matthew's order until he comes to the Last Supper. Passages from Mark, Luke, and John, introduced at successive stages of the narrative on what principles he determines their place, it is difficult to discover. Why, for instance, should he be given the account of the visit of Nicodemus to our Lord in John 3:1-21 after the story of the barren fig tree, and for far on towards the close of our Lord's ministry? In this singular order, Ephraim agrees with the Arabic text. But while it is apparent that the contents and the arrangement of the Arabic Diatessaron are practically identical with the contents and arrangements of the Syriac Diatessaron used by Ephraim, the readings of the translation show that the text had been revised, and Ephraim's quotations represent a more ancient text than the represented by the Arabic translation. And now, having told the story of the discovery of these two ancient books, the Diatessaron, and the lectures upon it, I have to show their value in relation to the question of the early origin and the historical trustworthy of our four Gospels. Tatian was a man of intellectual vigor and a scholar. There was fierceness in him and obstinacy and intolerance, but his address to the Greeks gives one the impression that he had courage and incorruptible honesty. He was a friend of Justin, and he had traveled far and had seen the Christians in many lands, and what for many immediate purpose is as important as any of the facts which I have just recited, he was a heretic. The date at which he left Rome is uncertain. It may have been early AD 150 or even earlier. It can hardly have been as late as AD 170. There is something attractive in the suggestion that although he believed that on some grave subjects the faith, the practice of the Orthodox churches were at fault, he cared more for the rescue of his countrymen from heathenism than for the correction of the theological and ethical errors of those who had found eternal redemption in Christ. Whatever may have been his motives, he returned to the land of his birth and preached the gospel to men who had not yet received it. He found it necessary to give his converts the story of Christ in their own tongue, and he took the story as it is given in the four gospels. With this characteristic audacity, he cut out the genealogies which he regarded as inconsistent with the true conception of the greatness and glory of Christ. and he did not shrink from tampering with the text of those passages which he retained. But the Gospels which he used, and the greater part of which he transferred to his own narratives, were the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and he used no other. Why did he use all the four? Why did he use these alone? He had broken with the Orthodox churches and was beyond their control. It was from himself that the churches for those who his narrative was prepared and received the Christian faith. He was free, absolutely free, to give any gospel that he chose. I ask again, why did he give them a gospel constructed from the four gospels which are still in our hands? There is an obvious answer to this question, and I think that the obvious answer is the only reasonable one. When he left Rome, these four Gospels had a unique place in the Christian church of all the lands. He knew they contained the real and authentic story of our Lord's life. You might think that the genealogies had no right to take place in the first Gospel and the third, and he thought it expedient to modify some expressions which might lead his converts into theological errors. But if he had to give his converts a narrative of our Lord's life, it was a matter of course that he should give them the story that had been told by Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. This was the trustworthy story. He could give no other, and although he had tampered with the text, his Diatessaron had so little in it to create orthodox suspicion, and contained the narrative in so convenient a form that Ephraim, the glory of the Syrian church, expounded it. Only 13 years ago, the evidence which could be alleged in support of the traditional theory that Tatian Diatessaron was composed of our four Gospels, though in my judgment sufficient, was scanty. To Christian apologists, Tatian's address to the Greek contained clear proof that he knew the Gospel of John. The following passages seem to place this beyond doubt. God is a spirit, and this is the saying, the darkness comprehended it, not the light, etc. Follow you the glory of God. All things have been made by him. Apart from him, he made no thing. But the proof was declared to be inadequate. The recovery of Ephraim's lectures and the Arabic translation of the Diatessaron has wholly changed the condition of the controversy. That Tatian, the friend of Justin Martyr, knew our four Gospels, and that his Diatessaron, he worked them into a continuous narrative, is now finally demonstrated. Couple more pages now. There is one more chapter to complete the story of this curious work, and you may be interested in hearing it. I have already told you that Victor Acapu, the author of the several commentaries on the books of the Old and New Testament, and of work now lost on the true method of determining Easter, met with a Latin MS containing a harmony of the four Gospels. That was about AD 540. The MS had no title, but finding in Eusebius that Tatian had constructed a Diatessaron, he attributed it to Tatian. After the MS had been copied under his direction, he corrected it and then published it with other books of the New Testament. Till recently, it was the general opinion of scholars that Victor was in error in supposing that Tatian was its original author. One piece of evidence seemed to be decisive. Tatian's Diatessaron was said to have begun with the first verses of the Gospel of John. In Victor's harmony, these verses are preceded by four verses from the Gospel of Luke. But the publication of Ephraim's lectures on the Diatessaron and of the Diatessaron itself has shown that Victor was right. The order in which the contents of the four Gospels are arranged by Tatian is followed with inconsiderable variation in the Latin harmony of the Victor. Harmony of Victor. This order is so remarkable, I might say, so wayward and eccentric that the coincidence could not have been accidental. Victor corrected the Latin text of the harmony and modified it in other ways. The genealogies, for example, and some other passages were probably inserted by him, but the harmony, even as it stands after Victor's revision, is substantially Tatian's. The harmony published by Victor, Tatian's harmony, had a great place in the history of the Christian faith in Europe. There is a copy of it in Fulda, in Hesse Castle, which according to tradition was in the hands of Boniface, the apostle of Germany, when he suffered martyrdom. If it's supposed that when the body of the martyred saint was brought to Fulda, the copy of the Gospels which he loved was brought with it, if the tradition is true and there is said to be internal evidence that the book belonged to the Boniface, the great missionary who in the 8th century evangelized the heathen races on the banks of the Rhine, used a narrative of our Lord's life which originally been prepared by the heretic Tatian for converts from heathenism on the banks of Euphrates. In the 9th century it was translated in the dialect of the Eastern Franks, and it appears to have been the basis of poetical life of our Lord, which was written for the Southern Franks and which had been intended to be sung to the harp. In the same century it furnished the substance of the Hiliend, which is described by its editor as the greatest monument of the old Saxon language in evidence. For 30 years, Charlemagne had endeavoured to compel the Saxons to accept the Christian gospel. They abhorred his faith, but could not resist his arms. They submitted to baptism and acknowledgement of the supremacy of the Franks rather than the confession of the authority of grace of Christ. But they remained heathen still, and they preserved the superstitions of their ancestors by singing in the depths of their forest their old songs in honor of their old gods. When Louis the Pious succeeded his father, he determined on a kindlier and more effective policy. He had not the story of Christ a greater charm than the legends of Woden and of Thor. If the Christian story could be told in song by a poet of genius, it might perhaps win the hearts of the wild, resolute men who, while they bore the Christian name, regarded Christ with indifference or hatred as the God of their conquerors. At the request of the king, Hiliend was written, a noble poem telling the story of our Lord as it is told in the harmony of Victor. According to its editor, it breathed the spirit of the old Saxon nation and customs, and the diction sometimes rises to a very high pitch of poetic power and beauty. There is no doubt, he adds, that the benign and beautiful doctrine of Christianity, by shooting the ears of ignorant heathen, would in this way find a ready access to their hearts. Coming to the end now. It is a wonderful story. The Diatessaron was prepared by a heretic in the 2nd century for the instruction of converts from heathenism in Assyria. In the 8th century and the 9th, converts from heathenism in the heart of Germany learned from it the story of Christ. Scholars lamented that it had been lost among other treasures of the East. And when within the last few years it was discovered, they learned that it had been known in the West for 1,300 years. There was ruggedness, fierceness, intolerance in the character of Tatian, but we may venture to hope that there was also genuine and even passionate love for his Lord. In the history, could he have foreseen it, of that story of our Lord's life which he prepared for his countrymen, he would have found abundant consolation for all the distrust and hatred with which he was regarded on account of his heresies. The service which he rendered to men for Christ's sake, Christ is glorious honoured. Well, I just think that some of the things about what R. Dale has written there, I thought it was excellent, an excellent essay. I just want to bring a couple of things out. Skeptics will often say that the Gospels are not historically reliable, that they were too far away, written to give us any genuine historical account. And what we see here is, if Tatian wrote the Diatessaron, which is the editing of the Gospel, then it means that the Gospels were already seen in the first century as valuable and important. And that is a powerful argument against any of these skeptics who would pour scorn and question whether the Gospels and even the New Testament is historically reliable. So, yeah, I just loved reading that. I loved thinking about Tatian and loved talking about the early church fathers and also the characters of these ancient times. But what a resource, and what a great scholar J.B. Lightfoot is, because he recognized that Tatian's book was around, would probably be around, and eventually it was found. And I just want to say that it's important for us to realize that our faith is based on good, solid evidence. This is evidence that the Gospels were in use in the first century. Here's a heretic doing a harmonization of the Gospels, not of the Gnostic Gospels, but of the four Gospels, showing you that they believed that the four Gospels had authority. So I'm going to go now, and I hope that you enjoyed this. I enjoy these historical videos, and I just hope that they've been a blessing to you and encouraged you. And so thank you for coming, and God bless you.